Good morning. How fun was that? You woke up, you came to church. Hey, you missed church, you missed out. We have Dennis Akajanian in the house today. What a gift he is. And longtime friend of this church and just a blessed man of God. And I love the way he carries himself. And we just honor you, Dennis. We honor your gift. And thank you for being such a faithful servant of the gospel and the Lord Jesus. Let's give it up for Dennis one more time. I also want to say happy Thanksgiving, and I see some brave people out on our outdoor venue. God bless you guys. Stay dry. I see your hand waving. God bless you guys. Thanks for joining us. If it does rain, just kind of make your way in. But happy Thanksgiving. We have so much to be thankful for. I'm thankful for my family. I'm thankful for this church. I'm thankful to call the United States home. We live in a blessed country. And praise the Lord. We have a lot to be thankful for. I don't know, Thanksgiving's right up there. It might be my favorite holiday. What's not to like? You've got football, food, more food, pie, gravy, turkey. I mean, all of it. I've got my stretch pants waiting. They're ready for me, you know, elastic waistband so we can just go hard at it. And then, of course, family. Who could forget? So lots to be thankful for this year. I also wanted to take just a moment to highlight our Nehemiah Fund. For those of you who are new, you don't know what that is. That's a special fund that my dad developed. And we use money that's given to this fund to specifically bless Israel and her neighbors. We have dozens of partners in Israel that are doing incredible works, including helping Jews make Aliyah. And so when you give to that fund, you're helping support all kinds of causes. And I also want to add this. There are also Arab causes that we give to, and we support a Baptist church in the city of Nazareth that is filled with 90% Muslim kids who are being exposed to the gospel. Praise the Lord. We also support a ministry called Hope for Ishmael. We recently made a disbursement through our Nehemiah Fund, and we're trying to get money into Gaza to help those who've been displaced by all of the war and the fighting. And so just wanted to highlight that. And also wanted to take a moment to applaud all of you who have helped out with our Operation Christmas Child Ministry. I am happy to announce that this church was responsible for packing more than 10,000 boxes. Praise the Lord. I think that makes us one of the leading partners for this ministry in the western part of the United States, so good job. Also, we had our sewing ministry provide over 2,400 skirts for these little girls, and when they open this box and they get to put on this skirt and really feel like a princess, it's just a gift from God. And of course, the gospel gets shared every time those boxes are handed out. In fact, Dennis is a longtime friend and partner with Franklin Graham and Samaritan's Purse and all of that, so we're happy to have him here. And then the last thing I wanted to mention, you need to jot this date down. On Wednesday, November 29th, so that's not this coming Wednesday, but the following Wednesday, we're going to be pausing our regularly scheduled services, and we're going to be hosting a special one-night event, Step Into the Story event. And the reason is we were recently contacted by our partners in the Jewish Agency, which is one of the ministries we work with in Israel, and they told us about these two women who lived in one of the kibbutzes that was attacked in the southern region of Israel on October 7th when Hamas sent terrorists into that region and they mercilessly attacked innocent civilians. And so these women were there. They ran into their safe room. The older woman, her son, tried to fight off the terrorists. He was killed tragically in the attack. And so they want to get the word out, and they're going to be here. I'll be interviewing them on Wednesday the 29th, and you're going to get a firsthand account of what happened. I want to use it as an opportunity for us to inform our prayers. We need to be praying more now than ever for the peace of Jerusalem, for an end to the strife and the conflict, and for God's kingdom to come and for the scales to be removed from people's eyes so that they turn to Jesus in these last days. Everybody say amen. 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 So that's Wednesday, November 29th. Mark your calendars. With that, let's go ahead and pray and we'll dive into the word. Did I tell you where to open? Joshua chapter 3. Joshua 3. And while you're turning there, I'll pray. Thank you, Lord, for your word. It's a lamp unto our feet, and it's a light unto our path. We pray, Lord, that you would take now your living word and you would use it like a surgeon's scalpel to cut away all the affected areas of our lives that don't reflect you. We also pray, Lord, that you would use your word like water to refresh our souls. Lord, would you use it like a hammer to chisel away at us and conform us into your image? Would you use it like bread to satisfy our souls? Would you use your word like fire to burn away the chaff? And ultimately, Lord, would you use your word to bring us closer to Jesus today? We pray and ask all these things in your name. And once again, everybody said, amen. Well, the title of my message for you today is, It's Time to Cross Over. And that'll make more sense as we get into our study. But the story we're gonna look at today, you need to know that it represents a significant milestone in the history of God's people. It's a moment that was quite literally hundreds of years in the making. After 400 years of bondage and slavery in Egypt, followed by another 40 years of wandering around in the Sinai Peninsula and the Judean wilderness, the Israelites were finally preparing to take their first steps into the land of promise. Now, this had always been God's plan for his people, to bring them into this good land that flowed with milk and honey. However, because of their rebellion in the wilderness and their unbelief, they ended up being forced to take an extended detour in the wilderness. And so a trip that should have only taken them 11 days ended up taking them more than 40 years. But now that time has passed, that generation had gone on, and the time had come for them to go in and take possession of the land that God promised to give to their ancestor Abraham. But standing in their way between them and their promise was this obstacle that they had to figure out how they were going to get across. It was called the Jordan River, and we read about it in the beginning verses of Joshua 3. Let's go ahead and begin reading there. It says, early in the morning, Joshua and all the Israelites set out from Shittim, and they went to the Jordan, where they camped before crossing over. After 3 days, the officers went throughout the camp, giving orders to the people. And they said this, when you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God and the Levitical priests carrying it, you are to move out from your positions and follow it. Then you will know which way to go, since you have never been this way before. But keep a distance of about 2,000 cubits between you and the ark. Don't go near it. All right, so these verses set the stage. You have the Israelites camped out right there along the eastern banks of the Jordan River. Now, unfortunately for them, the land God had pledged to give them was on the western side of the river. In other words, they were on the wrong side of the river. Now, typically, this wouldn't have been too big of a problem. The Jordan River isn't that wide at many parts, and so there were places where it certainly could have been forded. However, God just so happened to lead his people to the Jordan at the exact time when it was in flood stage during the springtime. During this season, the river could expand in various parts to be over a mile wide. Now, if the Lord had just brought them up from the south, they could have avoided the river altogether. If he had brought them to the river at a different time, in a different month, then they could have easily crossed. But he'd brought them here when it was overflowing its banks. So they were stuck. And you have to put yourself in their sandals. How frustrating it had to be for these Israelites to be so close to the land that God had promised to give them. They'd been waiting for so long, and yet they couldn't quite get to it. And I think some of you know what that feels like. You see, there are many parallels that can be drawn between the journey that the Israelites made on their way to the promised land and the journey that we take as followers of Jesus. In many ways, their story as a nation begins with their dramatic rescue and deliverance from bondage and slavery in Egypt. How did God deliver them? It was as they took the shed blood of an innocent lamb and applied it to the doorposts of their home. Similarly, our story as Christians begins when we take the blood of Jesus, whom the scriptures describe as the Lamb of God, slain from the foundations of the world, and we apply that blood not to the doorposts of our homes, but to our hearts, and we're set free from bondage and slavery to sin. From there, the Israelites passed through the waters of the Red Sea, mirroring the experience of the Christian as we pass under the waters of baptism, signifying our union with Christ. From there, they passed through the wilderness on their way to the promised land. Similarly, there is a promised life that the New Testament describes that God has designed for us to walk in. It's a life of purpose and meaning, of peace and joy. It's described as the Spirit-filled life. It's a life of victory and flourishing and abundance. Jesus described it like this in John 10:10. He said, "I've come that they might have life and that they might have it to the full." This is the life that Jesus left heaven and came to this earth and bled and died to procure for you and I, this life of blessing. Yet sadly, just like those Israelites who found themselves camped on the wrong side of their destiny, there are many Christians who never get to experience that full and victorious life that Jesus talked about. You see, some Christians spend their whole lives wandering around in a spiritual wilderness. They're forgiven, but they're not walking in freedom. They're saved, but their path is marked by a struggle continually. They're delivered, but they're still dry. They're going to heaven when they die, but their life is filled with defeat on earth. And what I feel like the Lord has brought me here to share with you today is God has more for you. It's like so many of us, we can see the life we long for, and it's just on the other side of the banks of the river, but we can't quite grasp it. And so God has given us this story to give us some handles and to teach us how we're to cross over into the life God made us for. So the first lesson we see from verses 1-4, and you can go ahead and fill in the first blank in your outline, is this. If you want to cross over, it starts with getting your eyes on the Lord. You see, for 3 days, as the Israelites sat by that river, their eyes were fixated on the raging waters of the river and the impossibility of their situation. I mean, there was just far too much water that was moving. Perhaps the strongest of them might be able to swim across, but what about the children? What about the elderly? What about the infirmed? I mean, I picture mothers with infants in their arms thinking, there's no way I'm getting across that river. It appeared as though their newly appointed leader, Joshua, had just led them into a dead end. I wonder if Joshua was wrestling with similar thoughts. Lord, why did you bring us here? But as they were about to discover what they saw as a dead end, God was about to turn into a doorway. Let that be the word of the Lord to someone in the house today. You see, God had a plan, and he was about to unfold that plan. And so it begins with getting your eyes off of the problem and on to the Lord. And Joshua sends officers throughout the camp. And here are the instructions they give to the people. They say, when you see the priests with the Ark of the Covenant on their shoulders, move out, follow them. Pretty simple enough. And notice, too, how they're told to leave about 2,000 cubits between you and the ark. In other words, let the priests go before you. Now, 2,000 cubits is equivalent to about 3,000 feet. So leave about 3/4 of a mile distance. Let the priests go out in front of you. Now, there were practical reasons for this. If the people got too close and everyone crowded around the ark, then those in the back wouldn't be able to see where it was going. And so by leaving space and by letting the ark go first, it ensured that everyone could follow. And there's something there for us. You see, God is telling his people, let me go before you. This is something he had already assured them he would do in Deuteronomy 31, verse 8. Let's go ahead and read this verse together out loud. It's in your notes. The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Well, those are some pretty good reasons to not be afraid or be discouraged right there. All kinds of wonderful things in that verse. But I love the way it highlights the fact that God not only goes with us in our journeys, but he also goes before us. In this instance, he's about 3/4 of a mile out ahead of the Israelites. And you might say the same thing is true about your life and your circumstances. He's gone before you and he's preparing the path for you as you prepare to enter the next stage of your life. He's 3/4 of a mile before you, 3/4 of an hour before you, 3/4 of a month ahead of you. He's already gone before you. And what that means is, wherever you find yourself and whatever you find yourself confronting, that is a circumstance and a situation that God has already prepared you for, and he's tailor-made it and crafted it to bring you into greater victory. Your only job is to fix your eyes on Jesus. They fix their eyes and their focus on the ark. We put our eyes on Jesus, who the Bible says is our author and perfecter of our faith. And when he moves, we follow. It really is that simple. Now, it was particularly important for the Israelites to keep their eyes focused on the Lord, because in verse 4, he says, then you'll know which way to go, since you've never been this way before. You see, as they crisscrossed their way through the wilderness, they would at times find themselves at a camp they had previously been at. But from this moment forward, every step they took would lead them into uncharted territory. These were places they had never been before. You know, the same thing could be said about your future, the one that the Lord is bringing you into. Each new day leads us into uncharted territory. I mean, none of us knows what tomorrow is going to bring or what tomorrow holds. Why? Because we've never been this way before. And so what happens is, when we find ourselves in unfamiliar territory, our tendency or inclination is to stay put. Right? We don't want to move out, and we're reluctant to step out until we have all the answers and until we have the full plan and we know exactly what God is doing. But what this story reveals is God rarely leads us like that. Instead, what he often does is he gives us just enough light for us to take the next step, and then he waits for us to move out in faith. We see this illustrated all throughout the scriptures. One instance would be with Abraham. Let's go ahead in Hebrews 11:8, what it says about Abraham. Let's read this out loud. By faith, Abraham, when he was called, obeyed and set out for a place that he was going to receive as an inheritance. He went out even though he did not know where he was going. This is a verse that I think describes why men have trouble with directions. We don't know where we're going, but we pretend like we do. Now, when God called Abraham, he doesn't give him the full picture. He doesn't give him all the details. He simply tells him in Genesis 12:1, go to the land that I will show you. Just start going and then I'll show you. Now again, Abraham didn't fully understand where he was going or what he was doing, but he sets out anyways. And that, friends, is the very heartbeat of faith. And God wants us to walk by faith. You know, we are all facing circumstances and seasons and life that we haven't been fully filled in on. Some of you are getting ready to be parents for the first time. You've never been this way before, believe you me. You are in for a ride. I'll never forget when I was bringing my oldest home from the hospital and thinking, I can't believe they let me take this kid home. I am so not qualified for this job. And there are still seasons when I want to look at my kids and I'm doing the best I can, but I want to just tell them, hey, I'm doing this for the first time. I've never been this way before. I've never been a parent. Can I get an amen from the parents in here? We've never been this way before. Some of you are getting ready to start a new job. You've never been this way before. You're getting ready to move to a new city. You've never been this way before. You've never been married yet. You're getting ready to get married. You've never been this way before. You see, there are all kinds of things that you don't know and can't know because you haven't experienced them yet. You're facing them for the first time. But don't let that keep you from stepping out in faith. Simply trust the Lord that he's gone before you, that he's prepared a path, and then follow his lead. That's what these verses tell us to do. Now let me give you the second point. If you're getting ready to cross over, then you need to get your heart right with the Lord. That's point two in our outline if you want to fill that in. And we see this in verse 5. So Joshua tells the people, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things for you. What a beautiful promise that is. God's gonna do amazing things tomorrow. But it starts with getting your heart right today. There's a powerful principle embedded in what Joshua says here. And it's this: if you want amazing tomorrows, then consecrate yourself to the Lord today. Now, consecrate is not a word that we use often, so let's pick it up and dust it off. To consecrate something is to set it apart for God's use. For instance, in the temple, there were all of these instruments and objects that were consecrated. That is, they weren't to be used for common or ordinary purposes, but they were to be set aside specifically for holy things, for the worship of God. And what the Bible clearly states is that what those priests did with those holy objects, you are called to do as a follower of Jesus with your life. We see this in places like Romans 12, where we're told to offer our lives as living sacrifices before the Lord in light of all that he's done for us. And so what the this whole concept of consecration, it involves abstaining from certain things. And that's usually what we associate with holiness, right? All the things you have to say no to. And growing up, I thought that being a Christian just meant abstaining from certain activities and avoiding certain behaviors. And it was all about no, 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 no. And certainly that's part of it. But there's this whole other side to consecration that involves wholly dedicating yourself to the things of God, surrendering your heart and will and giving God your hands and your feet and saying, everything that I am, I surrender to your service, Lord. And this is the picture of consecration. And when you do that, God will start to do amazing things for you. Now, notice he doesn't specify what the amazing things are. He just says it's gonna be amazing. And I love the ambiguity and the vagueness of that. I'm convinced that the Lord wants to do amazing things in all of our lives. It's kind of like this. There's this great verse in Daniel 11:32 that says that the people who know their God shall be strong and carry out great exploits. Again, a little bit of vagueness there, but I would categorize great exploits in the same category as amazing things. For Daniel, that meant shutting the mouths of lions. For the Israelites, it meant crossing a river and parting the seas. For you, who knows what it means? All I know is I want to take part in those things. But before we can experience those amazing things, we have to make sure that we're vessels that are clean, that God can flow through. The thing to note is there is this correlation between the power we walk in and the purity we cultivate. There is a connection between power and purity. When there's mixture in the life of a believer, when there's compromise, it inhibits the flow of God's power through you in the same way that like a clogged artery inhibits the flow of blood through a person's heart. But if we would decide today to consecrate ourselves to the Lord, surrender all that we are to him, you'd be amazed by the things that God would do through you tomorrow. Praise the Lord. So Joshua says to the priests in verse 6, take up the Ark of the Covenant now and pass before the people. So they took it up and they went ahead of them. And the Lord said to Joshua, today I will begin to exalt you in the eyes of all Israel so they may know that I am with you as I was with Moses. Tell the priests who carry the Ark of the Covenant, when you reach the edge of the Jordan's waters, go and stand in the river. So Joshua said to the Israelites, come here and listen to the words of the Lord your God. This is how you will know that the living God is among you and that he will certainly drive out before you the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Hivites, the Perizzites, the Girgashites, the Amorites, and the Jebusites. See, the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord of all the earth will go into the Jordan ahead of you. Now then, choose 12 men from the tribes of Israel, one from each tribe. And as soon as the priests who carry the Ark of the Lord of all the earth, set foot in the Jordan, its waters flowing downstream will be cut off and stand up in a heap. Couple of things I want to draw your attention to in these verses. First, notice how God doesn't speak to Joshua until after he tells the priests to pick up the Ark and start moving. So in verse 6, Joshua says, all right, it's time. We've got to move towards the impossibility that's before us. And as soon as he does that, God speaks to him and gives him the next direction. You know, sometimes I think we're sitting around waiting for God to share something or to do something. And the whole while, God's waiting for us to take the first step. And we realize that because as soon as Joshua takes the first step, the Lord gives him the next step. And here's the next step. He says, have the priest stand in the river. Now, what's interesting is that's all that God says to Joshua. And yet when Joshua relays the information to the rest of the Israelites, what he says is, as soon as the priests set foot in the river, God's gonna cause the waters to be cut off. Now, Josh is just riffing here. God didn't say that. We'd have no record of that. But what's happening? His faith is growing as he exercises it. And when he does that, what formerly had been muddy suddenly becomes clear. He realizes in this moment, oh God, you have a plan, and this is what's doing. And his eyes are being opened. He realizes right here in real time, God, you didn't lead us to a dead end, but God, you have a plan and a purpose. You're going to show yourself strong. You're about to reveal your glory and your power. You've brought us to this problem to reveal a pathway. God hadn't abandoned them. He had a plan all along. And that's what's coming to light here. You know, in these verses, we see at least three reasons why God led the Israelites to this supposed dead end. First, he knew that this generation needed their own personal power encounter with him. Think about it. These are the descendants of those Israelites who'd been rescued from Egypt. So it was their parents who got to see the 10 plagues poured out on the Egyptians. And no doubt they grew up hearing the stories of the frogs and the darkness and the locusts and then the Passover and that whole journey through the Red Sea. They hadn't been a part of it. These are their kids. And so God knows they need to tell their own stories. They can't rely on the faith of their parents. And so this story would give them a new beginning. It would give them handles and their own experience with the Lord. And by the way, God is wanting to tell incredible stories through you. I'm so thankful for the faith that has been handed down to my generation by those who've gone before me. Like my parents and the Jesus movement, and I watched the Jesus Revolution movie, and I'm inspired, and it causes my heart to cry out, Lord, would you do it again? And this really is the prayer of each successive generation. Lord, I've seen what you did there. Would you do it again for me? In fact, listen to the words of the prophet Habakkuk. In fact, let's go ahead and read them together out loud. This is Habakkuk 3:2. Lord, I have heard the news about you. I'm amazed at what you have done. Lord, do great things once again in our time. Make those things happen again in our own days. Even when you are angry, remember to be kind. Everybody just say amen to that. We've seen what you did. We heard the stories. But Lord, would you do great things once again? Now, the great things that God's going to do for this generation, while they are similar in nature to what he'd done for the previous generation, there are also some notable differences. For that older generation, he parted the Red Sea, and you'll remember that in that instance, he just had Moses stretch forth his staff over the waters and they parted. Yet here, God calls for a greater measure of faith, doesn't he? He says, I want you to have the priests step foot in the river, and then the waters will be cut off. You say, well, why is God asking for more from this generation? Well, because they had the added advantage of growing up in an environment where they were used to and got to know the heart of their father. And so God leads us in degrees. And the further you go, the more he will ask because he wants to build your faith. So that's one thing that's going on. Secondly, the Lord also wanted to use this miracle to establish Joshua as the leader of the Jewish people. He says to him right there in verse 7, today I'm going to exalt you in the eyes of all of Israel. I'm going to establish you as the leader. Now, he'd already been appointed to this position by Moses. He'd been confirmed by the Lord, but there were still some doubters in the crowd. And so the Lord says, I'm going to establish you firmly once and for all. And this event would certainly do that. But notice again how Joshua takes what the Lord shares with him, and when he relays it, it comes out a little different. Instead of telling the people, hey, today the Lord's going to really lift me up, so, you know, keep your eyes on me. Instead, what Joshua says is, today God is going to be magnified in your midst. He shows the heart of a true leader. He's humble before the Lord, and that's why the Lord was able to lift him up. And by the way, humility is always the sign of any great leader. Thirdly, God also wanted to use this miracle to build the confidence of his people. Remember, they're getting ready to go in and face all kinds of battles on the other side of the Jordan, and he wants to infuse them with boldness and confidence that the God who's gone before him in leading them through the waters of this river will also drive out all of their enemies, just as he promised to do. But it wouldn't happen until they had their eyes on him and their hearts were in the right place. But there was one more step that needed to happen before they could cross over, and we'll finish with this in verses 14 through 17. It says, so when the people broke camp to cross the Jordan, the priests carrying the Ark of the Covenant went ahead of them. Now the Jordan is at flood stage all during the harvest. Yet as soon as the priests who carried the Ark reached the Jordan, and notice, as soon as their feet touched the water's edge, the water from upstream stopped flowing. It piled up in a great distance away at a town called Adam in the vicinity of Zarephath. While the water flowing down to the Sea of the Arabah, that is the Dead Sea, was completely cut off. So the people crossed over opposite Jericho. The priests who carried the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stopped in the middle of the Jordan and stood on dry ground while all Israel passed by until the whole nation had completed the crossing on dry ground. Here's the final point in our outline today. If you want to cross over, you got to get your feet wet. You got to get your feet wet. Notice when Israel experienced the miracle. When did it occur? It happened when their feet touched the water's edge, and not a moment before. Why? Again, it had to do with this thing God was wanting to build in his people. He was wanting them to demonstrate their faith before he sent the miracle. Now, let me just say this in passing. There are so many different ways to please God, but none apart from faith. For according to Hebrews 11:6, without faith, it is impossible to please him. Evidently, in light of whatever God has planned for the rest of eternity, he thinks it's necessary and important for his people to develop strong faith now, which is why he leads us into trials. Those trials aren't given to us to destroy us, but to test us and to build our faith. He's wanting to grow your faith. Now, the Bible talks about various kinds of faith, and I want to highlight three different kinds of faith here as we get into our text. One type of faith you'll find described in the Bible is dead faith. I think we can all agree that's not the kind of faith we're trying to build. James talks about this in his epistle. James 2:17 says that faith without works is dead. In other words, if your faith is nothing more than it's kind of like a dry adherence to a set of theological positions, but it's never impacted the way you live, it's never produced any kind of fruit in your life, then the Bible would say your faith is dead. You see, biblical faith means far more than just believing the right things. It means acting on those truths. Faith isn't a noun, it's a verb. It's an action word. And so we don't want dead faith. Here's another kind of faith you certainly don't want. Demonic faith. Can we all agree we don't want to build demonic faith? What is that? Well, again, it's James who tells us. This is James 2:19. And he basically says, you say you believe in good, in God. That's great. Even the demons believe this, and they tremble in terror. Again, what James is saying is, it's not enough to just hold the right truths and believe the right things. If you think about it, demons have surprisingly good theology. They know that Jesus was God's son, that he left heaven, that he came to the earth, that he possessed all authority, that he died on the cross, and that he rose from the dead. But no demon is going to heaven. We can agree on that. Why? Because they've never personally surrendered to Jesus. And that leads us into this third kind of faith. This is the kind we see illustrated in our story, and it's the kind God is wanting to build in each of our hearts. And that is dynamic faith. It's dynamic principally because it is evidenced through our actions. This kind of faith, it reaches beyond the intellect. It's more than adherence to a creed or a belief that God exists, but rather it goes beyond that into active trust. And this is what God is looking for. Dynamic faith is what led Noah to build the ark. It's what led Abraham to leave everything and everyone he knew and set out in an adventure going to an undetermined place. It's what led Peter and Andrew to leave behind their fishing business in order to embark on this journey of faith with Jesus to become fishers of men. And it's what led these priests in our story to step into the waters of the Jordan and be willing to get their feet wet. A little story helps illustrate the point I'm trying to make. Back in 1859, the most famous tightrope walker on the planet was a guy by the name of Charles Blondin. And he's famous because he became the first man to walk on a tightrope over Niagara Falls. Can you imagine that? Without a harness, without any safety nets or anything like that. And he was suspended 270 feet above the raging waters of this river. The rope was tautly stretched over the 1,100 feet that connected America to Canada. And he hopped up there, and tens of thousands of people gathered to watch this spectacle unfold. And he makes his way across, and then he comes back, and the people cheer wildly. And then he grabs a wheelbarrow, and he takes a wheelbarrow across the same line, and he makes his way back, and the people go even more crazy. Then he fills the wheelbarrow with bricks, and he goes over, and he comes back, and he does this a number of times, and the people are just loving it. They're eating it up, and he says, "Who thinks I could put a man in this wheelbarrow and bring him across?" And they all cheer and go wild, and he says, "How about you?" And the guy's like, "What? No. And he demurs and he chafes and he balks and he refuses. He had an intellectual belief, but he didn't truly believe. Now, what if there had been a kid in the crowd and raises his hand? "I'll go with you." Sure enough, the kid hops in the wheelbarrow. He goes across, he brings him back and hops back out, and all the people say, "What on earth possessed you to be willing to get in that wheelbarrow?" And the kid comes back with his answer, "Well, it's easy, he's my dad." And herein you see the difference, right? Between an intellectual assent and true dynamic faith that makes its way into your feet. Real faith is stepping into the unknown because you're confident in the God you know. It's trusting his certain plan, even in uncertain times. It's getting into the wheelbarrow. And that's what these priests demonstrated. Now, they had wet feet. But you'll notice with me that everyone else got to cross on dry ground. The dry ground is mentioned a couple of different times in our text, including at the end of verse 17. And he brings that up repeatedly to drive home the point that this was a true miracle. It wasn't just like some event happened and then walked through on the mud and everybody got stuck. No, the ground was dry and everybody got to cross it. And the reason is given to us because God caused the waters to be stopped a great distance away in a little town called Adam. Now, if you look this up on a map, Adam is about 20 miles north of Jericho, 20 miles upstream, if you will. Now, here's where this gets really beautiful. What this means is, long before the priest stepped foot in the water, God had already set this miracle in motion. He set it in motion in advance of them getting to the river's edge. You see, the miracle happens downstream, but that's only possible because God was already at work upstream, 20 miles away, out of line of sight of anybody. And again, this is so powerful for us because many of us, we feel like we're trapped on the wrong side of our promise, and we're looking at this impossible situation that is keeping us from getting into that life that God bled and died to secure for us. And we think we can't get across. Maybe it's some sickness or a job loss or depression or tragedy or discouragement, and you can't see how you can get past this thing. Well, this story is here to remind us that we serve and worship a God who is hard at work, and he's working upstream from your life, perhaps out of sight, but he's doing that in order to affect your downstream life. You see, if God has brought you to this place, it's not to defeat you, but it's to deliver you. It's not a problem to crush you, but it's a pathway to further you in your faith journey. He has a plan to get you through it. He has upstream solutions for all your downstream situations. It may just be that he's working right now behind the scenes, out of your line of sight. And all he's waiting for is for you to step out in faith, to move forward in confident assurance that the God who brought you to this place has a plan and a purpose to bring you through it. If you'll step out, if you'll just get your feet wet, I'm confident that God will do amazing things for you. You step out in faith, and then you watch him work. Let's go ahead and pray. Thank you, Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your grace and your power, your might and your majesty, the way you have it all figured out, the way you have a perfect plan, and you're walking us in that plan. You know, the Psalms say that the Lord makes firm the steps of the one who delights in him. I read that in the Psalms this morning, Psalm 37, I believe verse 19. Though he may stumble, the psalmist goes on to say, he will not fall, for the Lord upholds him with his right hand. God wants to establish you in your steps. He wants to lead you through this impossible situation on dry ground. And I can't help but wonder if I'm talking to anybody in here this morning who feels like, man, just for the longest time, you've been stuck. You feel trapped on the wrong side of your destiny. Yes, you're a Christian. Yes, you've seen the Lord move just like those Israelites had, but man, it's been a long time and you feel like you're still in the wilderness, and that life of promise, that life of abundance, that life of victory that God sent his son Jesus to bring you into, that remains elusive. It remains just beyond your reach. And today you're sensing that God is leading you out. He's calling you to get your feet wet. Well, we don't have a river to step into today, but I do want us to take a symbolic step of faith. And so if that's you and God is calling you to deeper places, he's calling you to trust him in greater measures. He's calling you to get your eyes off of the problem and fix your gaze on him. If he's calling you to consecrate yourself in greater measure and to get your feet wet, you just go ahead and stand up right now. And as a sign of your faith in him, this will be your way of stepping into the Jordan. And you're saying, I'm not staying in the past, but I'm moving forward with the Lord into the future he has for me. Praise the Lord. Now, those of you who are standing, I want to lead you in a prayer. So just hold out your hands like this, palms facing up, because we want to assume a posture of receptivity. And I want you to pray this. Lord, I feel weak, but you make me strong. I don't have what it takes, but you do. You're more than enough. Your grace is sufficient. You will bring me through and lead me in. I step forward in faith to lay hold of the life you bled to give me. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's let the rest of us stand to our feet and let's worship the King.
All my ways fall short. I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must stand, but you never do. So I throw my hands, praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing high.
Praise the Lord. Let's bless each other before we go. The Lord bless thee.
The Lord bless thee.
and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee. The Lord bless thee. And keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee, and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Amen. God bless you guys. Have a wonderful week in Christ. If you need prayer, go ahead and come down to the front.